Penguin Random House Audio presents The Book of Jose, a memoir by Fat Joe and Shaheem Reid. Read for you by the author, Fat Joe.
Part 1, Bronx Tales. Chapter 1, The Birth of Joey Crack. The streets crowned me, the realest walk in the earth. I earned it. Motherfuckers have been trying to kill me my entire life in one way or another. I've been shot multiple times in front of my mother. When I was just 10, a grown man named Papi Loco wrongfully accused me of trying to kill his infant daughter by throwing batteries from the roof of Forest Houses Projects in the Bronx, and then pummeled me until I was bloody and had a concussion. When I was a young teen, a street don tried to scare me to death by threatening me to stick my entire arm in the meat grinder. The police have done their best to beat me into oblivion. When that didn't work, crooked cops try to frame me for murder so I could do life in prison. Through it all, though, I never folded. People said it was suicide when I went head to head with a gangster known for butchering adults and setting infants on fire. I squared up with the feds when they tried to stop me, and just when I thought shit was sweet, some of my best friends and family died or went to jail or betrayed me. My name is Fat Joe, a.k.a. Joey Crack, a.k.a. Jopra, a.k.a. the Don Cartagena. But on August 19th, 1970, I was born Jose Antonio Cartagena at Bronx, Lebanon Hospital. The South Bronx, to be exact, an auspicious and ominous birthplace. Life in the South Bronx could feel like a movie. What kind of movie? Here's an emblematic South Bronx tale. 16 years after I was born, right across the street from Lebanon Hospital in the Fulton Avenue tenement projects, a 20-year-old Larry Davis got into a shootout with damn near the whole police force. Not only did Davis get out there alive, he left 6 cops filled with lead. He was like a hood superhero. Nobody could believe his story. He was eventually caught after a 17-day manhunt, but in court, his lawyer's defense was corrupt police were trying to frame Larry for the murders of some drug dealers. And when they stormed his sister's apartment, they were trying to kill Larry, not apprehend him. The defense worked. Larry Davis was acquitted of all charges except illegal gun possession. God bless the dead. Davis was eventually killed in prison in 2008, where he was doing time for a case unrelated to his famous shootout. Me? By the time Larry Davis made his mark, I had already been earning my own stripes as a shorty. My history with violence started almost as soon as I got out of the womb. I'm the youngest of 4 kids, the baby of my family. My mother, Ruby, had 2 sons and a daughter before me, Angel Jr. Raymond and our sister Lisa. Ruby got married to their father, Angel Cartagena Sr., when she was still very young. Angel was a bad guy who intimidated everyone around him. He was in jail when my mother met my father. Ernesto Delgado had just moved to the U.S. from Cuba. Ernesto, or Ernest as he was called in this country, was a little guy. He had a big heart, though. My father busted his ass to provide for us. He was a baker. He was a carpenter. In the summertime, he would sell ices and pastelillos in Crotona Park. He taught me what it meant to be relentless. Ernesto always worked hard, but he went extra hard in pursuing Ruby. My mom is a beautiful Puerto Rican woman. Both her parents are from the island, but her father is Taino, one of the indigenous people of Puerto Rico. My grandparents migrated from PR to the BX when they were still teenagers, and that's where they raised my mother. Whenever my grandfather's family would come from Puerto Rico and visit us in the Bronx, which would only be about every 5 or 10 years, they come dressed in traditional garb. My great aunts and them wore moccasins and reminded me of images I'd seen of Native Americans. Ironically, my grandfather was named Cowboy. My mother and her family all lived in the same building as my father's sister, Esther. Yes, I had a real-life Aunt Esther before that name became famous via the classic sitcom Sanford and Son. My aunt was nothing like LaWanda Page's outrageous Bible-toting character, though. God bless them both. Once when my father was hanging out with Esther, he laid eyes on my mom, and it was love at first sight for him. He would see my mother all the time and go try to rap to her. He didn't care that she had 3 kids already. Shit, he had 9 himself. They were back in Cuba with his wife. Stay tuned for the story down the line. Ruby and Ernest started spending time together, and the next thing you know, she became his girl. They moved in together with my mom's kids in the Bronx Forest Houses Projects on East 165th Street and Trinity Ave. 1000 Trinity, to be exact. They lived in apartment 5E, which had 2 very small bedrooms and 1 bathroom. Soon after, Ruby got pregnant with me. All the time, Angel Sr. was in jail. My mother had moved on, but she was still married to my brother's and sister's father. When I was born, I was given the name Joseph Cartagena because mommy was still legally a Cartagena. She actually still is. My mom and Angel Sr. never officially got divorced. Angel got out of jail damn near right after they cut my umbilical cord. Back on the streets, he caught wind of my birth and made a beeline to the PJs. He started yelling in front of the building, threatening to kill my mom. Then he threatened to kill my dad. Finally, he declared he was going to kill a baby. What the hell did I do? I wasn't even a full 2 months old already in the mix. As Angel was making his way into the building, my mother frantically ran out the apartment with me in her arms and gave me to the neighbor down the hall. My mother's instructions were concise. Don't open the door under any circumstance. Angel finally made it up to the 5th floor and started banging on my parents' door, yelling once again he was going to kill the baby. The man in the building heard the commotion and gathered together to confront Angel. They told him, you can't be threatening her. When Angel Sr. resisted, the men in the building busted his ass. They beat him to a pulp, then dragged him out the building and told him to never come back. Angel came to accept my mother and dad's union without any more threats of violence. My mom is such a loving and forgiving person, she would let him see his children. Unfortunately for my brothers and sisters, he wasn't a real father. He never even gave him as much as a lollipop. He helped to make them biologically. You gotta be grateful for that. But that man wasn't a real factor in their lives. And he wasn't nothing to me. I didn't really know him like that. I might have seen him once or twice when I was real little. He would look at me and I would look at him like he was weird. I don't know why. I didn't know the story of how he vowed to kill me. I just knew I didn't like that man or anything that came with him, even his family, who I'd see whenever they came to visit my sisters and brothers. I didn't like them either. It was just in me. My mother would be like, this is your sister's aunt. I'd be like, man, if these people don't get the fuck out the house. I was just a little kid, but my intuition has always been on point, even as a tyke. Angel wound up repeating the cycle of getting incarcerated, being released, coming home, then going back in. Eventually, he died of cirrhosis of the liver. He was also drinking too much. My father Ernest drank a lot too. Not as much as Angel, but Dad loved that fire water. Almost as much as I loved to eat. My family, even though we were poor, we ate good. My grandmother thought he was the best chef in the family. The best chef in the world, if you really want my opinion. She was phenomenal. And she loved to make sure the whole family enjoyed their meals at the gatherings. When I was little, there were a lot of grandkids around my grandmother's house. It was like 50 of us. 50 grandkids running around. But I would be the only one under the table. My reputation as the family black sheep preceded me. So at the gatherings, my family didn't even give me a chance to get in trouble. They kept me on lockdown as a precaution. One time I started a fire at my grandmother's house. Other times I broke our chairs. You know, I was always fat, so I would jump around on the furniture. The weight and pressure of me jumping on the chairs would break their legs. On a couple occasions, I would break a chair and put the leg back on it. I wouldn't tell anyone I broke it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.